You're watching a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
Life was a little quieter.
Everything was downtown. That was the business district.
Every kid in a radius of 100 miles would come so they could ride the escalator.
We had a lot of neat drive-ins at Sioux Falls.
The music that was being played at the time, I thought it was the most exciting thing I ever heard.
Life in the 50s was nothing but simple and fun.
I would call the 1950s the halcyon days.
When you think about Sioux Falls in the 50s, you think about, you know, a slower paced community.
Life was a little quieter. I mean, it wasn't so hectic, I don't think, as now, is where you have to keep going and keep going all the time.
Full of change.
I think the 50s were optimistic because we had gone through World War II.
When we were growing up back in the 50s, we never locked our doors on our house, never locked our car doors, never thought about it.
Your word really was meant something, and your friends really meant something to you.
We didn't have some of the pressures, some of the worldwide involvement. Things were stabilized.
There was a lot of optimism of people, and people worked hard, and everybody was, you know, respectful of one another.
Never had to worry too much about traffic because there really wasn't a whole lot of traffic back in those days.
Your neighbors all knew what you were doing. And when you went outside to play in those days, if you misbehaved, one of the neighbors would reprimand you, and they felt, you just felt part of a big family.
People had fresh ideas as far as stylings go. TV was coming around. The jukeboxes definitely had a big change. Kind of went from the old world design to something really ultra modern at that time.
You know what a big thing was when we finally got a dial telephone? The telephones were all black. There was no colored telephones. You pick up the receiver and then you wait for the operator to come on.
Making your own fun with your cars and your music.
We had our heroes, everybody did. We had our movie stars.
And then you start paying attention to the car stylings that came out, the fans. That was pretty awesome.
When we think about the decade of the 1950s, we do think of a time when life was a little bit slower paced, you could always count on your neighbor to lend a hand, and new ideas and inventions were bringing big changes, changes that brought an enthusiastic optimism about the future. In Sioux Falls, life in that decade was no different. Whether you're talking about the 1950s or today, life in Sioux Falls has always been pretty good. That much hasn't changed. However, Sioux Falls, the city, has seen some changes since the 50s. Let's compare. In the 1950s, Interstates 90 and 29 hadn't been built yet, but Highways 16 and 77 were there. There were no shopping malls in the 1950s, but the department stores downtown had everything you would need. The Sioux Falls Arena hadn't been built yet, but the Sioux Falls Coliseum was the place to go for big events. The Sioux Falls Airport, Joe Foss Field, was there and handling around 40 cargo and passenger flights per day. Washington High School was the only public high school in the 1950s, but it wasn't this one, it was this one. O'Gorman High School hadn't been built yet, but Cathedral Catholic High School was there. And finally, Falls Park was not there in the 1950s, but the Falls were. Today, the city of Sioux Falls covers about 63 square miles. But in the 1950s...
The Big Sioux River, or Kiwanis Avenue, was the boundary on the west.
Kiwanis was about it for going west.
Kiwanis was probably not paved at that time.
Behind the Veterans Administration was cornfield. Absolutely still agricultural cornfield.
Some people lived out on Marion Road, and that was like a major trip if you went out that far. That was a long way out.
26th Street was practically near the end of town.
If you went past 33rd Street, there just wasn't anything beyond that.
33rd Street was cornfield. That was not developed. 26 was barely being extended out there.
I think the paved roads stopped about 33rd in Minnesota.
You know, like 41st Street was just a two-lane, and I think it might have been a gravel road.
To the south, 33rd Street, I think, was the boundary, and south of 33rd Street was another community called South Sioux, and they eventually became part of Sioux Falls.
Going east, there wasn't very much on the east side.
Cliff Avenue might have been the boundary going to the east.
The east side of town, probably Cliff Avenue seemed to be about the boundary, maybe a little bit east of there.
Sycamore was way, wasn't even there, that was out of town.
North side never really changed a whole lot.
Probably the airport was the boundary on the north.
It was a very small, encased community at that time.
17 square miles, 18 square miles.
The winter snow which blankets our city may be disliked by our friends in Florida and California, but because of its life-giving moisture, these same friends are supplied by truck and rail with South Dakota food. Five of the largest railway systems in the Northwest serve Sioux Falls, which acts as a leading distribution point. Nearly 700 beds are available in Sioux Falls' three excellent hospitals. Our homes reflect our economic prosperity. 700 new housing units have been constructed in this city within the past 2 years.
Those were the days where people looked after each other, you know, parents and mothers and dads. If you did something wrong, you knew you were going to get a call home to your mother, or they were going to tell your mother, and then you had to answer to them. And you really couldn't hide that much, because it seemed like somebody always knew somebody that knew your mother. So, and nobody wanted to go through that experience.
There were a lot fewer policemen back in those days.
We had about 6-7 beat officers downtown. We had 3 cars, and I remember, all of the city. 3 squad cars. East side, west side, downtown, 2-man cars. That was all we had.
I think we as kids got away with a little bit more, and well, we also got to know most of the policemen.
Little things were big things. If a neighbor bought a new car, that was a big deal. If a neighbor bought a new Chevrolet, I mean, everybody in the neighborhood was over there to see it.
And I can remember living on North Spring. The home I lived in is now part of the parking lot for Burger King at Minnesota Avenue and Russell, and is no longer there. And I can remember leaving, going out of that house and crossing over to the north, over what is now Russell, and Russell Avenue, and there was no development there. There was just large, big crabapple tree, trees in that area, and we used to go over, I remember, and climb up in the trees and have crabapple fights.
It didn't take very much to make us happy in those days, because we thought we were having fun, and we were having fun.
In the 1950s, a kid growing up in Sioux Falls could always find something to do.
It was a great treat for myself and my brothers and my friends to get a paper sack with a peanut butter sandwich in it and take off hiking. We'd go hiking in the hills. What used to be called Cactus Hills in the northwest part of the city. And that was, you know, that was a mile or two hike from our house. And so it was a great treat for us to go hiking in the hills and looking for arrowheads or, you know, pretty rocks or whatever. If we weren't doing that, we loved to fish.
We would ride our bicycles out Old Highway 16, which had to be a dangerous thing, you know, back in those days. But we did it, 12 miles, and we'd go out and we'd fish in Wall Lake, and there we could, especially in the spring of the year, we could catch a ton of bullheads. And we thought that was a classy fish back in those days, because we'd come home and our dad showed us how to clean them, and then mom would fry us bullheads in butter that night, and oh, that was good.
One of my, you know, strongest memories is fishing down at the falls. As a teenager, we used to go down to the falls, and there really wasn't a park to speak of, so you had to kind of crawl over everything to get down to the river, and then we'd fish and have some great fishing down there for catfish or carp, or if we got lucky once in a while, we'd catch a northern.
Chase around neighborhoods and played tag, and You'd have to go find enough kids to play baseball or football or basketball or hide and seek or kick the can. But you're always active. I mean, it just seemed like, you know, the worst part of the day was when the mother started calling you home because it was time to eat or to get ready for bed or something like that, and you just hated when it started to get dark because you knew the game had to be called pretty soon, you know, because you're playing until you couldn't see the football anymore. When I was growing up in the 50s, we would take and we would walk downtown, and that was the way you got around. I mean, there's bus services, but you would you'd walk downtown.
I grew up in Lenox, and I grew up on a farm, and I was one of five kids, and there wasn't much excitement at all, and I really didn't get to Sioux Falls very often, and when I did, it was a real eye-opener for me, having come from a little town. And we would get to go usually in late summer, and of course it was the one big shopping trip, you know, so we could buy new school clothes.
The Friday nights and Saturday nights, especially during Christmas time and holiday time, wall-to-wall people.
I can remember at Christmas time, when you'd go downtown, the windows would be decorated in a Christmas theme.
Downtown, you have to remember, downtown was it.
Downtown was the center of activity. I mean, that's where everybody shopped, that's where everybody played.
There was no malls. When you shopped downtown. There was no other place to go. JCPenney's, Montgomery Ward's.
Fantles, department stores.
Weatherwax's, men's store.
There were several little dress shops.
Sue Barbershop.
Susan Roebuck.
There was Copel's dress shop.
You didn't get appointments back then for your haircut. You just have to go down and sit in a chair and just wait your turn.
It used to be what they call a palace of sweets.
They had Caldwell's on the corner.
And everybody, if you're in high school, everybody's getting a flat top.
And that was really a meeting place because the high school was right near there.
Kresge's, the dime stores.
The nickel plate.
Shriver Johnson's.
Greasy, some kind of substance to put in, you know, in your hair to make sure it stood up.
Newberry's, JCPenney's.
Everything was downtown. That was the business district.
As I got into high school, the choice, the store that you used was Weatherwax was a big men's clothing store.
Weatherwax's men's store, which was where anybody that really wanted to buy some nice looking clothes, they'd go to Weatherwax's. That was the place where the guys would want to pick up nice sport coat or jackets or good shoes or that sort of thing.
And so as you started making some money between Weatherwax, Crawford's, and maybe to a small degree E.C. Olson's, but Crawford's and Weatherwax were really big stores to buy your clothes at. I mean, that's where everybody would buy their clothes. Fantles was a really neat store. They had some neat clothes in there.
Fantles was another clothing store, but it was, to us, it was more the elite, you know, so, you know, Mom never shopped there.
So you'd go in there and you'd look around and, you know, you'd look at the clothes that they'd have in there, and, you know, a lot of us didn't have really the money to buy it, but you'd always dream.
I remember specifically, you know, people buying hats, and they'd carry it out in a hat box, you know, rather than a sack. So that was kind of neat as a kid, too.
In the early days, even in Fantos, there was a gentleman who would greet you at the door when you came in, and it was like a personal visit. As a customer, you would come in, and one of Mr. Fantle would stand there and greet you.
If you really, really wanted something special, you might go to Fantle's to buy that, you know, like a winter coat or something. But boy, if you did, you know it was something very special you took very good care of.
Then Shriver's was big at the time.
Shriver's was a real big department store for us. We'd, you know, take the elevators and go upstairs and look around.
Riding the elevator in the Shriver's to go to the mezzanine, you had to go on an elevator, and that was just really exciting.
Yeah, it was a big department store there. They had everything in there.
In Shriver Johnson, no one remembers this, but Mr. Gesford was a tall, stately man, and he would look like a floor walker, you know, just striding along, always greeting the customers.
You know, you could go up, I think, if I remember right, you could go up, you know, like to the second level, but there was like this mezzanine. It was kind of just another little level, and you'd get to ride the elevator.
They had a place upstairs where you could eat.
Shriver's used to have what was called Shriver's Tea Room.
The Shriver Johnsons had an elevator, and on the mezzanine you could buy your shoes, and they also had a little tea room there.
And they were one of the main places downtown Shriver's was at that time.
The downtown shops and department stores were filled with all sorts of things to see and to buy. But there was one store with a very special attraction.
Well, JCPenney's had the escalators, and you could go in there and ride the escalators.
When they put that in JCPenney's, that was a big deal, boy. That was the front page of the Argus later. I mean, it was unbelievable that you could have something like that. I mean, just stand on a step and ride, you know, didn't have to walk. I mean, it was unbelievable.
That was a big thing. That was a big thing.
You know, to get there and go to JCPenney's and, you know, ride the escalator. I mean, what an awesome thing to ride an escalator.
The only one we had, everybody was proud of it.
I mean, that was like a big city then. That was really starting to take on the looks of a big city when you had escalators. And that was just a real novelty to young people.
And every kid in a radius of 100 miles would die to come to Sioux Falls so they could ride the escalator up and down.
Especially kids, but I mean, even grown-ups would come into Sioux Falls from little towns around, and you'd have to go down there and ride that escalator.
Oh, it was. You know, I could stand and just watch it. You know, just watch people going up and down. And then, you know, when you finally got to take your turn on it and to ride all the way up, it was great.
It was more fun than an elevator because as you're going up or down, you could see an overview of everything.
Mm-hmm. We never thought of things like nowadays you walk into a business and the door opens for you. I mean, if we would have had anything like that then, I mean, it would have been unbelievable. So it was a big highlight.
Another big treat in those days was to go downtown to the old dime stores that were downtown.
On 10th and Phillips Avenue, there was Kresge's, and they had a big soda fountain there. I mean, of course, the big thing, my favorite, was a root beer float. And then they had, across the street was Walgreens.
Going to the soda fountain at Woolworths.
Right across the street from the State Theater was Lewis Drugstore. And in those days, I mean, you could buy clothing in there, you could buy jeans and all those things even then in those days. The nickel plate, that was another one. And you could walk in there and they had these cherry phosphates in there, and I mean, they had all this good stuff.
They all had soda fountains, so if you're lucky, and I think I might have had a paper route or something back in those days, so I always had a little money, and we'd go downtown and get an ice cream soda at one of those places.
It only cost 5 or 10 cents.
To see the lights, you know, if we shopped long enough, you know, where we'd have to go home at night, the lights of the city. When you drive home, it was like, wow, I was there.
Saturday was the big day because that's when we could walk downtown and go to the movies.
Downtown, it was the Egyptian Theater.
We had the State Theater.
You had the Orpheum.
Granada.
There was a State, the Egyptian.
Egyptian Theater. Used to go there.
The Granada and the Orpheum and the Egyptian and the Hollywood and the State.
Then we had the Time Theater.
The Strand.
The State and Hollywood.
I can remember the Time.
Further north on Phillips, we had the Strand Theater.
Dakota and the Granada.
Dakota, Time.
The last one on North Phillips was the Orpheum.
There were half a dozen movie theaters in downtown in those days.
It was quite a few movie places downtown.
Back in the days before we had television, things were vastly different. People went to the movies.
The Egyptian Theater was there, and that was on 10th there. That was a beautiful building. It was a big theater.
The thing I remember, it cost a dime to go to the movies.
If you had a few more pennies, you could get into the State Theater or even the Hollywood for that matter.
The State Theater was 15 cents when they first went there, and of course 5 cents for popcorn. Try that nowadays.
Really, the Cadillac Theater down there was the State Theater. Really a nice theater. Beautiful, beautiful theater. Seated a lot of people, and so when you really got big movies, a lot of times they would go there.
You know, not only the price, but the different kinds of movies. Typically the 9 cent movies were the Cowboys and Indians, and the other ones were romantic novels or that sort of thing.
Mom would, myself and my two brothers would give us each a quarter, and we'd go downtown and we'd go to the matinee movies and see Buster Crabbe and his Jungle Rats and Flash Gordon. I think you've heard of Flash Gordon, haven't you? I don't know if you've ever seen some of those old films, but Flash Gordon would blast off in his spaceship and his little, and how they did that on TV, but had a little smoke tailing out behind it, you know, as it was flying across. But we loved it. We thought it was great stuff. And for a quarter, you could entertain yourself and just have a great time.
Theaters were really big back in those days. And you know, when we were growing up, it was going and watching the Dead End Gang and Roy Rogers and Gene Autry. And
a lot of them were cowboy movies.
All their fighting started out one Sunday morning when old Grandpa Coy was full of Mountain Dew.
One of the greatest thrills for me was to go to the movie theater on Saturday afternoon and see my old-time hero, Roy Rogers. We always argued as kids, though, because he was called the King of the Cowboys, and had a lot of disagreements with some of my friends. They thought Gene Autry was King of the Cowboys, but he wasn't. It was Roy. Got a chance to meet him once too, about a year before he died, and that was a bigger thrill to me than being able to have dinner with a president of the United States.
I think it was called Movie Tone or something. There's a news back, you know, that they have on, and I can remember going and watching that, and they'd give you a glimpse of you know, the Korean conflict or some other event that was happening around the country, and so. That's kind of a way you've got to see it. Today, you just turn TV on, you got 24-hour news channel. Back then, I mean, TV was not non-existent for me. And so the movies were a way to see what was going on in other places and to see people you had heard about, famous actors and actresses, and it just became a way of life for all of us. It was a big deal.
Well, James Dean, he was big. Rebel Without a Cause, that was one of his big movies. And he wore a red jacket in that movie. And after the movie came out, 2 or 3 weeks later, everybody at school where I went, they had red jackets on. I mean, everybody wore the jackets.
My dad was a projectionist. He ran movie pictures. And I can remember, you know, I used to go down and he ran, when he was running the Egyptian Theater that was downtown, I can remember having to go down there, and he was a janitor also. And I can remember getting up and they'd have a major movie on, like, The Robe or something like that, that was very popular, and it just packed the theater. So we'd have to get bright and early. I mean, 4:30 in the morning, it was so early, it seemed like, and go down and clean the theater because he had that. And then he would run the projection in the projection booth. And then at night, he would go out to the Starlight Drive-In and be the projectionist out there.
And there were two drive-in movie theaters.
East Park Drive-In and that was out on East 10th. And then we had, on the west side of Sioux Falls, we had the Starlight Drive-In Theater. And of course, that was a big, big thanks for everybody, including the parents. And I'll never forget, at the Starlight Theater, I had my first piece of pizza. And I'd heard about it. And of course, I knew that Italy was famous for pizza. I tell you, the first piece of pizza I had, it was one of those things where it was frozen, and they would put it on a kind of electric heater, and it was like a dollar, I think. Oh man, I'll tell you, I knew from there on I was going to be a pizza fan for life.
They used to have Buck Night at the drive-in movies. You could get the whole carload in for a buck, and that was always a lot of fun.
It was really fun because, you know, on a hot summer night, you sit there, you have the speaker, and you've kind of been in your own living room. And it was just, you know, privacy of your own vehicle. And a lot of times people would, you know, get a group of people together and just, let's go to the drive-in.
Another big thing at the outdoor movie theaters is every so often they would have a dusk to dawn movie. And of course, in the middle of the summer, it never got dark till 9:30, quarter to 10, but they would run movies all night long. And you could just sit there and just, for one price, which is usually, I think, probably about 75 cents, you could watch movies all night. In fact, we did too. And by the time we got, when the sun was coming up, maybe 4 a.m., 4:30, we had probably seen about four or five movies and ready for bed.
Going to the movies was a popular way for people living in Sioux Falls to find entertainment. But in the 1950s, a new form of entertainment was just beginning.
We didn't have a station here at first, but you could pick up Channel 9 at Sioux City, and it would come in real snowy.
I remember the first TV set that I saw was one of the neighbor kids up the block. They had won a TV at the Red Owl store in a drawing.
Well, we didn't have a TV, so we had to go see the neighbors, but there's some pretty good shows on.
We didn't get a television, though, in my house. We didn't get a television. I think I was like 58 when we got a television. The first television that we had in our home.
A lot of times on the weekend, usually bought TVs at like an appliance store, and on the weekends they would put these black and white TV sets in the window. And it wasn't any sound or anything, but people would walk by and they would stand there and watch the TV.
And I can remember watching Rocky Marciano in a heavyweight fight, and it was just like watching all snow, but you thought it was the biggest thing you've ever seen.
When I would do my paper route, I'd go around and I would collect at night. And boy, and if I seen an antenna on a house, why'd you stand there and they'd stare, you know, while they were getting their money, and they'd be watching Sioux City, but it was so snowy, you couldn't hardly see the picture, but they watched it anyway.
And then all of a sudden, you know, you started seeing televisions come, and you started seeing the antennas pop up on top of houses, and when you looked around, I mean, it's just all after, you know, so many years back, probably in the mid-50s or somewhere, all of a sudden you'd see all these antennas on top of houses, so. That, and people trying to adjust them. And I can remember my aunt and uncle when they had black and white TVs. And you could get this cellophane stuff. It was like green, red, and yellow, I think. And you put on it so it looked like you had color TV.
When Kellogg came along, TV started taking off quite well.
And I think it was about 1953 in Sioux Falls. And, I tell you, that was a big thing.
This is a great day for all of us. We've been waiting for this for a long time. It's taken many, many, many months of construction, and yes, even years of planning. So we feel very happy that we can bring you our program today and say that we're on the air. It's a very happy time also to announce that we are the first television station in South Dakota.
Well, finally, we got TV in Sioux Falls. And before they signed on, they had a test pattern. People were so excited, they'd sit and they'd watch the test pattern for an hour or two. You know, there wasn't even any programming on.
And there's favorite programs that people would just really glue themselves to the TV set.
And the first show that we saw was Dragnet. And man, that was something else.
One of the shows I really liked was the Hit Parade. They had some really good acts on there.
There was Bonanza, and when I watched, and Have Gun Will Travel was big. Route 66 was a really a great program when, you know, you get a little older and that. But you know, I Love Lucy was on, and Jack Benny. There was just a lot of programs that were really family oriented. I mean, everything was back then. I mean, everything you watched was really family oriented.
And the most exciting thing was to be able to see the faces, put the faces together with the voices that you heard on radio. Because when we were growing up, radio was the big thing. I mean, we listened to Amos and Andy, and we listened to Sky King, and Bobby B, and B-Bar-B writers, Bobby Benson. I mean, that was a big show. Of course, Roy Rogers, the Lone Ranger. And we would get so excited as kids, you know, and then they'd always advertise like a breakfast cereal, like Quaker Oats, and you could send in a box top at like 15 cents, and you could get like a Roy Rogers ring, and it would have a secret compartment in it where you could keep your notes and stuff. I mean, that was big. And of course, now when television came along, you could see all these people and see what they looked like.
At night when the news came on, that was really big. People really watched the news, and the weather was, and that's still a big day, but the weather was always a hot item for people to watch.
Because of the high winds, but things will change this evening. We'll talk about that. This cool mass of air right now is almost in a straight line right down through North Dakota on down, swings around into Texas, and that will move out of our territory sometime tomorrow morning. The winds will shift. It's due to warm up.
You hardly wanted to go to bed at night. I mean, you just wanted to watch TV all the time. And of course, that changed things forever. And the way we live and the way we think today, I mean, is a lot of it is because of television.
1950s television brought entertainment right into our living rooms. But the 50s brought one more form of entertainment that was sweeping Sioux Falls and the world.
The music changed forever in 1955.
One. Two. 1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock. 9, 10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, rock. We're gonna rock around the clock tonight. What is that?
That's when the movie Blackboard Jungle came out, and that's when the song Rock Around the Clock came out. And I'll never forget when I first heard that at the Hollywood Theater, and that changed music forever.
Heard the music that was being played at the time. I thought it was the most exciting thing I ever heard.
KIHO, that was the top station, and it was a 24-hour station. They weren't very powerful back in those days. It went on about 50 miles.
And they used to play the top 40 songs. And you just had this little radio with one speaker, and you used to listen to the top 40 songs.
The kids, that's what they did when they were in school. They all had their radios turned to 1270 on the dial, KIHO. You know, that's where all your favorite Elvis hits and Conway Twitty and on and on and on.
Today, I mean, you can go buy CDs, you can go do a lot of things. A lot of times, we didn't even have the money to go down and buy the record, you know, of them. So when you heard it on the radio, this is big stuff.
That got me interested in going to the music store, Sioux Falls Music, which is downtown. And they had these booths where you could take a record and go into the booth and listen to the record and see if you wanted to buy it or not. And I thought, boy, that's a good way to listen to some good music, you know. Of course, those kids didn't have any money, but so we just go down there and listen and walk out. But one time I did go in there and I bought Jerry Lee Lewis' record, Great Balls of Fire.
The one late at night everybody listened to was KOMA, Oklahoma City.
You had to wait, you know, until later on at night, you know, because there was too much static.
You listen to KOMA at night because that thing just boomed up here.
And I remember as a kid, for Christmas, I'd gotten a transistor radio. And it was one of the biggest gifts I'd ever gotten because I had my own radio instead of trying to sit in the kitchen, you know, and tune in the kitchen radio. And then I could take it to my room versus being in the kitchen with everybody else. And on a bright, you know, starry night, you know, you had your music. The music was just awesome.
The music of the rock and roll stars from the 1950s was sought after by every teenager. In Sioux Falls, you didn't have to look very far, because Sioux Falls had her own rock and roll stars.
Myron Lee and the Caddies.
Myron Lee.
Myron Lee and the Caddies.
Well, I was boogieing on the highway with my baby next to me. We were going strictly nowhere, driving easy as could be. Well, I heard a roar coming. It was fierce through the air. And I said to my baby, we gotta go and drag here.
What I remember the most when I was growing up in high school was Myron Lee and the Caddies. Myron Lee and the Caddies were really a very popular group around here.
But he traveled, he played venues all over the United States, and I think was on the Dick Clark Show a couple times, which was a very popular music show back in those days.
Well, I grew up in a musical family. My dad played accordion, and he played piano, so by the time I was 5-6 years old, he was teaching me chords on a piano, and then when he would go, he had a band himself called Bob Swingsters, and a lot of times when he would go out and play jobs in Sioux Falls, I can remember the old Melody Hall, used to be on Maiden Avenue upstairs, he would take me along, and I would sit there all night long and listen to the band and watch all the players, and once in a while, if I was good, he would even let me sit in and play drums once in a while. That was a big thrill for me. I started a group in 1958, and just friends of mine. We had a great saxophone player that was in the band, and the first band was a combo. We didn't even really have a name. I played piano. We had a string bass player in the band, and a saxophone player and drummer. And so happens at the same time, rock and roll was just taking over the country. You know, big. That was the big rage. And so I figured if we wanted to get more jobs, we better get into the rock and roll music instead. So I did like so many young kids did back in those days. I went down to Sioux Falls Music, bought myself a $75 guitar, $75 amplifier, and started a rock and roll band. First, my name wasn't on the billing. It was just called the Caddies. And that was because at that time we were earning part-time money out at Minnehaha Country Club as Caddies. And I figured that would be kind of a nice clean-cut name. And it wasn't after the Cadillac car like many people thought. It was after the job that we had. So in 1959, we recorded a record and up in Minneapolis. And we started getting a lot of airplay locally. And they put Rona Baby on the rotation, played day and night. And all of a sudden, we had more jobs than we could handle.
Rona Baby, come hold my hand. I want so much to be your man. Rona Baby, I want you so much. Rona Baby, to feel your touch. Oh, oh, oh.
That was a thrill to hear yourself on the radio. In fact, when the records came in from Minneapolis, they came in by bus, and we waited down at the bus station waiting to get those packages of records, you know. I couldn't wait to start sending them out to radio stations. And we would sit glued to the radio, waiting to hear that record played. It was really quite a thrill. We just kind of branched off. People began hearing the name, began to see the band, and they would talk to other people. And before too long, we were playing in 100 miles of Sioux Falls. That was pretty big for us back in those days. Of course, can't forget the Arcota Ballroom. And that was, I believe, built in the late 1930s. All the big bands, all the famous Glenn Millers and Lawrence Welks, I mean, everybody played the Arcota. Well, then when rock and roll came along, we started playing there too. We played the Teen Hops on Thursday nights and just would pack the place. I mean, it was just so much fun. You'd see all the kids that you went to high school with and grade school, and everybody danced. It seemed like everybody knew how to dance. And growing up in the 50s, that was one of the main things people did. The kind of dances everybody was doing back in the 60s and 50s was, I would say, describe it as kind of a spin-off of the swing dance days from the 40s. I think they begin to change it somewhat when they used to see kids dance on the Dick Clark Show, American Bandstand, but that's what everybody did. And of course, the older generation would always say, "Oh, those kids don't know how to dance because they don't stand and they don't hold hands. They're dancing 5 feet away from each other, you know." But I mean, that was the style, and of course, that style is still here even after all these years. As time went on, I got to know Buddy Knox. Buddy Knox had a big hit record called Party Doll. He saw the band and he liked it real well, and eventually he hired my group to go out on the road with him. And one thing led to another. Got to meet Bobby V. He was from Fargo, North Dakota, and he was turning out hit after hit after hit. Got to know him. We started doing all his live shows all over North America. He got me with Dick Clark. Pretty soon we were doing the Dick Clark Caravan shows all over North America, and it was kind of like the old adage, it's not what you do sometimes, it's who you know. And that's exactly what happened to the band and I. We just happened to get in with the right people at the right time, and it just ended up turning into a wonderful 35-year career in music. And everybody said that rock and roll will only last a few years. And here, that music is so fantastic that here it is, it's still here today.
If you weren't dancing to the music of the Caddies at the Teen Hop, you could always hear plenty of music blasting from radios in cars cruising the loop or parked at their favorite hangout.
We had a lot of neat drive-ins at Sioux Falls. Ray's Drive-In.
Donna's Drive-In.
Kirk's Drive-In.
Cutler's. Frosty Treat.
A&W Drive-In.
The Cottage.
Bob's Drive-In.
The Castle.
It was Ricky's Drive-In, was over on the west side of town.
Ricky's
Drive-In.
Ricky's Drive-In.
Yeah, Ricky's but Drive-In.
We called it Ricky's Quickie Chickie.
Ricky's Quickie Chickie.
His famous thing that he sold was Ricky's Quickie Chickie.
Perfected a recipe for fried chicken. And so that became known as Ricky's Quickie Chickie.
They just put the chicken in a big basket. I mean, I don't think it was anything that's extra special, but then they would drop it in that good, healthy oil, you know, and cook it for a few minutes. And that's what he called it, Ricky's Quickie Chickie. It only took about 5 minutes.
Or you'd just go out and drive around. I mean, gas was probably 25 cents or something. You find somebody had a car.
You could drive all night long and 50 cents worth of gas.
I think our loop at that time was downtown was Phillips and Main.
You just ran around till you found more people, and then when you find more people, you just, you know, maybe switch and do something with somebody else for a while because somebody else wanted to do something new. You want to do something different.
Driving back and forth out on West 12th Street, Kirk's Drive-In, to Ray's Drive-In, Bob's Drive-In. And then the rest of the loop would be driving down Minnesota Avenue. And the highlight of the whole thing was the Barrel Drive-In.
The owner of the Barrel was Lloyd Egan. He started it in 1939. And he and his wife operated it continually.
The hangout back then was the Barrel.
Well, that was this legendary hot spot for the kids.
That was a very, very busy place. I mean, it was the most popular teenage hangout in Sioux Falls.
Well, you know, the Barrel was really the place when you used to go through and drive through, and you could always find people there that were your friends.
My girl was driving, and I was sitting in the back, and she was driving with another girl, so she says, "Dad, you lay down in the back so they can't see you, so I can drive by the Barrel." So I had to sit down in the back there so they wouldn't see me, so she could drive around the car.
And of course they had car hops in those days too.
The neat thing about the barrel driving was the car hops.
Of course, if you were a young teenager like I was, you go to see the car hops too. That was all part of it.
The car hops would come out and serve you whatever you wanted, your ice cream or your hot dog or whatever.
The car hop would see a new car come on the lot, and they were trained to watch for new cars coming in, and they needed to really be on the ball to get out there and take the order.
We'd all have like a pizza burger or something like that, or a double cheeseburger, and then the car hops would come out. Like in the summertime, a lot of times they'd be dressed in neat little outfits and all, and short shorts, and all the guys I ran around with. I mean, that was a highlight.
It was kind of neat to see what car hop would be, or just watch the different car hops. That's why we'd probably get kicked out of it. We got kicked out of there sometimes because we didn't order.
She'd have an identification card with a number on it, and we had numbers up to 50 or so, for one for each of the car hops. And so she'd put that card under your windshield wiper so that she could identify, or whoever picked up the tray when you were done could identify whose order it really was, so the right person could get the tip. And you know, if you were known for not leaving a tip, you wouldn't get waited on real quickly. She'd have a printed menu that she'd hand to you, and then it was your job to collectively get the orders for everybody in the car. And she'd write it down longhand, which was another challenge, and she'd bring the order in to the inside of the building, and from the front counter it would be transferred to the back, which is where the kitchen was, and they would start to prepare the order, and when it was done they would send it out through the window between the front and the back.
I worked as a soldier at the barrel drive-in. My primary function was, when there was an order that came in, was to take care of the beverages, and usually was either a Coke or some other type of pop. But I spent most of my time at the ice cream machines making malts and making shakes and sodas.
Then the fountain people would, you know, put the drinks and all that on the tray, and then she'd carry it out and hook it onto the car.
You look forward to, you could drive up, order your food, and the car hop would come out, bring it, hook it on the window, and there you'd go.
You know, it's a tray about that big, and on one side it's got two little hooks, and on the back side there's a handle that you push up against your car door so that tray will stand suspended on your window. We had room for 100 cars in our lot. There were times when we had 12, 15 car hops on duty on one shift. And that's a lot of people to keep track of.
I'd have to have one of those ice cold root beers and those big thick cold mugs that it would take out of the freezer. You know, they were heavy. And then I'd have to have a deluxe hamburger.
Best thing about the barrel, they had great super burgers.
A wonderful cheeseburger with lots of lettuce and mayonnaise and tomatoes.
First double patty burger around is two patties, cheese, ketchup, pickle, mustard, onions, lettuce, mayonnaise, and tomato. And by the time you got through with it, you were a mess.
It was probably the best hamburger ever made in Sioux Falls.
Most people could only eat one, but there were a few courageous ones that would try to eat two, and they'd get it down.
Oh man, they were good.
But we had, hamburgers, hot dogs, french fries, chicken, shrimp, barbecued ribs, and all the assorted malts and shakes and sundaes and drinks. And when you're finished with your order, you'd either honk your horn or blink your lights, and she'd come and get your tray and end of the visit.
They had to hire a security cop there because of the troublemakers, us troublemakers. People would go out, exit out the back when the cop was out front, and lay rubber down the block.
You know, when they took off, if they had a car, they had to squeal their wheels.
But they'd always wait for the cop when he moved to the front. catch them.
We never had big troubles with the barrel driving.
Summer families used to go out, and that'd be a real treat to get that root beer float.
I don't know. It was just a neat place. I mean, that's where everybody went.
But you'd go out the barrel, and you could always find somebody to hang out with.
Sometime during the night, if you were out cruising, I mean, that's where you ended up with the barrel drive-in.
Probably not very many people know about was all the different romances that occurred and then marriages afterwards. And of course, I met my wife there, and she was a car hop, and she was a switchboard operator also. And we were married in 1959.
People really knew the barrel. That's kind of been institutionalized, I think, in the history of Sioux Falls. Those were, you know, I think those are precious times to have. You really built some really good neighborhood relationships that lasted for a lifetime.
Life in the 50s was just nothing but simple. That's the word I think of, is simple. Simple and fun.
Just having a lot of fun, you know, laughing and enjoying the music. So the carefree time.
A good feeling that things were right and society was on the right track. And growing up in that era, you felt secure.
This was the golden years, I would say, of Sioux Falls, and it started mushrooming and blooming and extending its arms, and it became really a metropolitan community in those years.
It was just a time of enjoyment.
I don't have any bad memories about it at all.
It was a caring community, and these were lovely, lovely days here in Sioux Falls.